Dear students, welcome to our class on ancient agriculture practices and scientific basis. We are going to learn some ancient agriculture practices and their scientific basis in this class. Before we actually go into the class, a quote only to inspire you. Stone never melts. Courageous person is never defeated. Stone never melts. Courageous person is never defeated. Only to inspire you. Thank you. So let us go into our class. Ancient agriculture practices and scientific basis. Just for half minute, we tried to understand what we studied so far. In the first class, we tried to understand what is agriculture heritage. Agriculture heritage is as simple as techniques that are handed over as a tradition. Techniques that are handed over as a tradition. Then we try to understand what are the ages or stages, stone age, bronze age, iron age, then periods. What are the periods in agriculture? Heritage, ancient period, medieval period, and modern period. Now in this class, in the ancient period, what are the agriculture practices? What is the scientific basis? Then in the third class, we try to understand genesis of agriculture and its chronological arrangement. So the Indian Council of Agriculture Research, with a wonderful report by two highly experienced classical scientists, based on that prehistory, proto-history, historic period, we tried to understand. And in this class, we are going to discuss what are the ancient agriculture practices and their scientific basis. Just before this class, in the third class, we tried to understand the status of farmers in the ancient society, status of mothers or women, advices by sages to the kings for the benefit of agriculture. We tried. Now in this class, we are going to discuss ancient agriculture practices and their scientific basis. Now in ancient agriculture practices, farmers evolved an efficient system of crop production and protection through generations of experience and intimate knowledge of their environment. That means soil, plant, atmosphere, continuum, how in the ancient times they followed. Okay, that's what. Recent advances in several branches of agriculture sciences have thrown light on scientific basis of these time-tested practices. What are the time-tested practices? Several are there. In this class, we are going to discuss only very few of them. Organic farming, summer plowing, stubble burning, rice banana rotation, mixed cropping, pits with straw lining, neem tree and products like neem leaves, neem cake, neem tree itself, grain storage, seed processing. These are all the ancient agriculture practices for which we are trying to understand scientific basis. These are only very few. This is the basis class. In the advanced classes, I would like to enlighten you with so many other ancient agriculture practices. Number one, let us go straight. Organic matter. Application of organic matter to the soil is one such practice of ancient agriculture time. This organic matter, besides supplying nitrogen to the crops, the farmer add manure, FIM, and green manure also serve as a primary source of carbon or food substrate to billions of soil microorganisms. We now know that beneficial effect of soil organisms such as Trichoderma bacillus, whose populations increase manifold after FIM in several of our agronomic and soil science field experiments. We now found that FIM has got this wonderful advantage. Now, in addition to the increased carbon dioxide that accumulates due to increased respiration of the multiplying microbe, inhibits which one? Carbon dioxide. Increase in the carbon dioxide inhibits the activity of soil borne pathogens which are harmful. This is the first practice, organic farming. Let us go to second practice, summer plowing. Summer plowing is another cultural practice invariably followed. Summer plowing means after the kharif crop, then rabi crop. Okay, we go for summer fallowing for some time. We never plow, we never go for any crops in that. We get keep it fallow but we go for plowing. What is its advantage for the next crop that is grown in the kharif season, next kharif season? Now, summer plowing is known to expose resting spores of soil-borne pathogens such as sclerotium to solar radiation, leading to reduction of their inoculum. In Rajasthan, it was shown that this practice caused rapid decay of onion debris containing alternaria and consequently reduced the inoculum in the soil. Now, just I would like to enlighten you, when we go for summer plowing, we expose the soil, more soil surface particle, more area of surface particles is exposed to solar radiation. Once it is exposed, some sort of eggs, some sort of pathogens, and their decay occurs. Therefore, the next crop is benefited through summer plowing. First one is organic matter. Second one is the summer plowing. Third one now, let us discuss. Stubble burning. Stubbles means when we harvest one crop, 4 or 5 or 6 or 7, maximum 10-12 centimeters, we leave. It is because for easy cutting or harvesting of the crop, we leave it there. Sometimes we go for burning. In modern days, it's not advised because of several reasons. However, summer after a crop is harvested, we leave it like that so that soil won't get eroded through wind erosion. There were some other advantages. However, the stubble burning has got some other advantage. What is it? After harvest of rice crop, the stubbles are burnt before preparing the field for next crop. Rabi crop is paddy. We have harvested, we left the stubble, we go for some sort of burning. This burning practice reduces the inoculum of Leptospira, and hence the stem rot incident in the subsequent rice crop is drastically reduced. When we burn the stubbles, of course, again I am reminding that, you know, stubble burning is nowadays causing some sort of other problems. However, in the ancient times, it was practiced, it has given some advantage like this. That's only I am trying to impress upon you. Now, let us go to the fourth practice. Rice banana rotation. Okay, what is the advantage? Rotation of rice with the banana helped to reduce the inoculum of Fusarium oxysporum, okay, which causes phenoma wilt on the banana crop. Okay, it has been found that under water saturated conditions in rice fields, the population of this particular pathogen is reduced below the minimum threshold level when this rotation is practiced. Okay, this is the advantage of rice banana rotation. Fusarium, okay, which is causing Panama wilt, is drastically reduced. Okay, on the next crop. The next one is the mithril cropping. Mithril cropping helps to reduce airborne fungal diseases as well as vector-borne viral diseases. When one short crop chili is grown with a tall crop of sorghum, for example, the aphid vectors carrying the stylet-borne viruses, for example, potato virus, first alight on tall crop and make a few feeding crop to find out its suitability as food. In this process, the virus present in their stylets is lost. What exactly does it mean? Presume that it is a tall crop of sorghum. Presume that this plant is a short crop of chili. What is happening? The aphid vectors carrying the stylet-borne viruses first go to this sorghum crop. They try to eat somewhere here. During the process, what is happening? The virus present in the styles of the particular virus is lost here. Consequently, when they move to chili crop, short crop, they have very little virus in their styles, and hence the virus transmission is greatly reduced. Virus comes here, lose the pathogen. When they fall on the short crop of chili, virus is lost. This is another advantage. Tall crops also act as wind barriers, affecting the free movement of wind-borne spores of several foliar diseases. Thus, the spread of foliar fungi diseases is greatly controlled. So, this is the tall crop of sorghum. This is the short crop of chili. So, this tall crop acts as a barrier for wind-borne spores. Okay, this is another advantage. So, let us go to pits with straw lining and other ancient practices. What are the pits? How the lining of the pits helps us, that we are going to understand. This is a wonderful technology. Several ingenious practices of storage of vegetables and grains are in vogue from ancient times. Winter vegetables were preserved for use in summer in pits lined with wheat straw all four sides. Nowadays, those who have money, they can go for fridges, very, very big fridges, what. At that time, fridges were not there. Now, what the ancient farmers did, they had gone for pits on the soil. So they lined all the four sides, okay? East, west, north, south, and bottom also, they lined with this wheat straw, for example. This wheat straw acts as the insulator for movement of heat energy into the pits. So when they stored the vegetables or grains, they were protected not only from the heat but also from the microbes, because that much of insulation effect is there. That is the advantage. Then neem tree and products. What are the products? There are, we discuss only three here: neem leaves, neem cake, and neem tree itself we discuss. First, let us discuss what are the advantages of neem leaves. For grain storage, neem leaves have been used, and on the rice bags when they are kept, they protect against several pests. The storage pests from nearby fields happens. Neem tree is now found to be an effective air filter and protects the environment. The leaf area of 1 square meter of neem tree absorbs 2.88 grams of dust. At the same time, neem tree is not sensitive to toxic chemicals. This has been proved in Bhopal grass tragedy of 1984, that when methyl isocyanate was released, some crops like mustard, radish, fenugreek, they were totally destroyed up to 2 kilometer distance, whereas the neem tree survived. The trunk survived, the branches survived. In the next season, what happened? The trunk and branches were not killed. In the next season, the trees rejuvenated. In the next spring, the dried leaves contained no residue of this methyl isocyanate. So this is the importance. Neem leaves have a very good advantage over the when they are spread over the bags of the rice. Similarly, neem cake, when it is applied to the soil, there are so many advantages. Now let us go to grain storage. The first known method of grain storage practiced by man was in underground pits for storage of large quantities of grain. When large quantities of grains were harvested by the farmer, the first storage practice was they go for digging of the pits, go for some lining with the straw, and they store it there. It helps in innumerable ways: heat, against heat, insulation. Okay, two, grains get protected from the pathogens because oxygen is cut off. Another thing, for the thieves, during the ancient times, they used to protect the grains from theft also. So grain storage practiced is underground pits. Now, when we go for the scientific reason is depletion of oxygen and increase in carbon dioxide happens in the pits. These conditions are adverse for survival of storage pests. Today, in controlled atmospheric storage, hermetically sealed bins are used to replace oxygen by carbon dioxide, which causes anoxia and kills the insects. That means nowadays we are using hermetically sealed bins only to do the same activity: cutting of oxygen, increasing of the carbon dioxide, or replacing oxygen with carbon dioxide. Nowadays we are doing, farmers did, ancient farmers did in the underground pits the same thing. Now let us go to some small quantities of grains are stored in earthen vessels, in houses, and closed with lids. Okay, 100 kgs, 50 kgs, 200 kgs, 150 kgs. They were stored in the earthen vessels. Before they stored, you know what they did? the vessels are painted with castor oil, which is now known to be a barrier to moisture ingress. Earthen vessels, they used to keep the grains. Before that, they used to paint with castor oil, which acts as a barrier for ingress of moisture. That means moisture cannot enter and spoil the grains. Let's go to seed processing. As far as seed processing is concerned, nowadays we are using technology. Wonderful, wonderful technologies are available. We are able to get wonderful, highest quality of seed. However, during the ancient times, what they used to do was, in the absence of technology, high level technology, what used to do? Seeds are treated with, in the ancient time, seeds are treated with coal ash before storage. This is an age old practice in which larvae and adults of storage pests that attack the grain at the time of storage are killed. Coal ash acts and it absorbs moisture from the seeds, thereby kills the pests already inside the grain. Nowadays, activated clay is used for same purpose. Earlier, ancient time, that was the thing. Similarly, pigeon pea seeds are coated with red earth. Very good advantage. That notorious pulse beetle lays eggs in mature grains in the field itself. The harvested grains contain grubs inside. The red earth coat prevents the emergence of adults from such seeds. The insects die inside the grains itself, thus giving good this thing. The simple method of sun drying of grains, usually the simple method of sun drying of grains before storage reduces the moisture content. It has been found that storage insects cannot thrive in grains with less than 10% moisture. Usually we go for different times of harvest. Physiological maturity, harvesting maturity. Wherever, whatever the process we do, we try to keep our grains around 10% of the moisture. Grain moisture, we try to keep 10 to 12% even modern agriculture also. Now in the ancient time, what they used to do? Simple method of sun drying they used to do. What is the advantage? The source of infestation, that is the eggs, the larvae, and the harvested grains are killed while sun drying when the temperature is around 40 degrees centigrade. The other practices also we try to understand. In addition to what we discussed, our ancestors also were versed with, well-versed with horticulture, as can be seen from Thalavruksha of Akambarnath temple in Kanchipuram in Tamil Nadu. Four branches. This is the tree. Okay, four branches of a mango tree in the temple bear four varieties of mangoes. The tree must have been produced by inarching four seedlings of four varieties so that the trunk is united while the branches bear fruits of the concerned variety. That means, you know, this technology was already there in the ancient times. Ancient times means 10,000 years BC or 12,000 years ago. Another important innovation of our ancestors has been recently come to light. What is it? When the mortar of a 1,000-year-old temple tower was chemically analyzed, it was found to contain copper sulfide in addition to lime. Copper sulfide in addition to lime. This indicates that the mold inhibiting power of the mixture of these two, copper sulfate and lime. It is known for people 1,000 years ago. Thanking you very much. Before I say a formal thanking you, once again, I would like to impress upon you with information that after this class, four classes are over. In addition to knowledge you gain from my lectures, you should also get the marks. That's why in these four lectures, I try to give you some bits, some important possible questions in your exams. Now, the quote of the class once again, stone never melts, courageous person is never defeated. Thank you very much. May God bless you.